Well, hello everybody. Time for another little update here, I guess. Once again, the roosters are sounding forth. I think you'll hear them throughout this clip. They seem to be challenging each other all the time now. I'm out in the hoop house, as you can see, but the title of this video is The Cabin, the Hoop House, and the Gardens. I've just finished staining and painting the cabin, so I want to give you a look at that a little later on in the video. Right now, we'll take a look around inside of the hoop house at some things that have been happening in here in the past week, and then a look at a few things out in the, well, one thing, I guess, the garlic out in the vegetable garden, and close it off like I've been doing with the last couple of videos with some of the spring flowers and whatever that have bloomed since the last update here. Try not to make this thing too long. I've been avoiding showing you this bed as I do various clips in here in the hoop house, but I'm getting around to cleaning it out today, so I thought for the fun of it I would show you before and after clips. That's what can happen to a bed even inside of a greenhouse that's left unattended. And it was commercial mixes of compost and soil, so I'm assuming most of that must have come up from down below. I didn't use a weed barrier. Anyway, this is the before shot, and shortly I'll give you a look at the after shot. Well, these things are never quite as difficult as you think they're going to be, I guess, although it did get a bit warm in here. It was about an hour and a half clearing out the bed. There's a great feeling of accomplishment once you've finished. And the main reason why I wanted to get this done today, I'll show you in a few minutes time here, I want to bring most of my seedlings out from the light garden in the house. A lot of them will be planted in this bed eventually, but I just want to lay them in their pots on top of the bed for part of a week at least to get them acclimated to the hoop house before I knock them out of their pots and transplant them into the ground in here. So, give you a look at that in a second or two here. Well, that's almost everything out of the light garden. There are a few pots of things that I started later that still haven't been picked out and put into individual pots. Once I get that done, I can bring those out as well. And these things are looking a bit knocked around right now because I just took a watering can and soaked them down really good. They will use a lot more water in here than they use in the house. And everything there is not going in the hoop house here. The geraniums aren't going in here at all. But the other things, all of the plants won't be planted in here. I'm going to try to give each plant a lot more space than I gave them last year. I think that was a problem. I overcrowded things in here last year, so this year I'm going for space. You can see those tallest pepper plants in the back. I cannot remember the name, but I will put the updated plant list below this video. They've actually got blossom buds on them. The other peppers, the shorter ones, which probably can't make out in front of them, are a couple of varieties of sweet peppers and one hot pepper, which they haven't grown half as big as the hybrid ones, which were all planted the same day. But I suspect once I get them in the ground in here, they'll take off. Anyway, that is that for this little segment, and we'll see what comes next here in a minute. Well, I have leaves on grapevines. Now to see if I can get some blossoms later on, and hopefully a few grapes. Again, this is the Beta grape, the one that is similar to a Concord grape, and Somerset next to it here, I won't bother swinging around to show you, it also has some leaves coming out. They're just not as far advanced. Beta seems to be more suited, I think, to our early spring climate, but I'm glad they both made it through the winter. Anyway. Well, there are fewer strawberry blossoms now, but hopefully that's because a lot of the ones that were there previously have been pollinated, and I know they have been. I can see small green ones coming everywhere. I no longer have to pretend that I'm a bumblebee, though. I came out with my art brush to go around the blossoms a few days ago, and discovered that I had either a leaf cutter bee or a mason bee, one or the other. If you watched my videos on the mason bee house last fall, last summer, when they were laying their eggs in my little mason bee house over on the cabin,
I can't tell one bee from the other, but I had both kinds building their chambers to put their eggs in the mason bee house. Well, I had one in here going from blossom to blossom doing his work, so I guess I'm glad that I have the mason bee house. I don't know if they actually came from my house or from somewhere else, but I went over and checked, and they have all hatched out. The tubes in the house are all empty now and waiting for some new inhabitants later this summer. It's warm enough out here in the hoop house now that I can start seeds in little pots directly out here rather than under lights in the house. And you can read the numbers on there. I'm putting the updated seed list below this video. But there is two kinds of squash, my winter squash variety and one that's calling itself a summer squash rather than just a zucchini. But I think it's a zucchini or similar to a zucchini. It's supposed to be a shorter variety, 6 to 7 inches long, which is the ones that I really like. I try to pick the other varieties when they get that size, but hopefully this thing at mature, that's what it's supposed to be in length, rather than finding those things hidden down in the leaves that are baseball bat size. And the other flat is full of calendula, a package of mixed colors calendula for... You'll see in a bit where some of those are going to go, and the rest of them are going to be here, there, and everywhere in the gardens. And that's the daikon, much larger and a lot more leaves than it had, and still growing in a bed of weeds. I've got to get a little cultivator, hand cultivator, in there and knock those down before they take over. Bit of a different angle on the peas, taken through the chicken wire frames there that I will be growing cucumbers up as soon as the peas have been harvested, but I'm still very pleased with these. They're probably, 6-7 inches tall now, and they are a dwarf bush variety. Lots of little tendrils coming on them, and the idea of planting the rows close together here is that as they get bigger, the tendrils will reach across the rows and they'll support each other. I did the same thing last year and it was fairly successful, so they don't need to be staked or anything anyway because they are a bush variety, but shouldn't be too much longer now and we'll see the first blossoms. The artichoke has really appreciated being out here in the heat. It gets cool in here at night. I presume it's down around 10 degrees or maybe even below 10 degrees, but it's up into the 30s, mid-30s here, and most of these days for the last 2 weeks we've had sunshine. So far today it's overcast, but can't complain after 2 weeks of beautiful sunshine, even though it was a bit on the cool side. That's some of the wild grape, the native New Brunswick River grape, that I propagated from cuttings a year ago this past winter. And I just healed them in here. They've been removed out of the bed and now they're over in the corner, but you'll see in a few minutes a couple of the places where I plan to plant them outside. I've counted 8, I think, seedlings in there, or rooted cuttings, whatever, well-rooted now. They're growing leaves. It's a vine that grows very rapidly, so I'm looking forward to it climbing up the trellises, and I'll show you in just a minute. This is garlic. Garlic that's been in the ground since a year ago last October. It wasn't full-size garlic cloves. I planted bulbils. Those are the little teeny garlic cloves that come on the top of the garlic plant, the scape that I usually cut off and make a dried powder out of them. It's an excellent seasoning. I left a few to save because I wanted to see how long it takes a bulbil to grow into a head of garlic. Well, I didn't lift any of them last fall. I just left them right where they were. And they've been up now since, early spring in here because it's been quite warm. And most of them have just sent up a single plant, which would indicate to me that it just grew a one clove down there. Two or three have got double plants, so they must have at least divided into two cloves. I'm going to let them go the rest of this season, and probably in August I'll lift them to see what's down there after 2 years' growth. I'll show you my other garlic that I planted out in the garden shortly. The rest of this long, narrow bed that has the garlic cloves in it there is planted with beets. I think the bed is 16 feet long, if I remember rightly, or something like that. Anyway, it's only a foot wide, so it's got one narrow row of beets down the center, planted a bit on the thick side. I'm going to try to let them grow up enough so that when I thin them, I can have beet greens to eat. I have horrible luck in the past growing beets, so I've done everything possible to this particular bed. I checked the pH that's required, and I added agricultural lime. I added quite a bit of my own chicken manure compost, the two-year-old stuff, some 444 organic fertilizer, and the glacial rock dust, which I said before, I keep adding. I don't really know if it does anything, but it doesn't do any harm. On the seed packet, it also said you could add wood ash to where you're going to grow beets. I think it gives extra potassium, is what they were talking about. So I cleaned out the wood stove in the cabin and added wood ash. They certainly have germinated well. So far, so good. I hope I get a nice big row of beets out of it.
Well, hopefully that's in focus. That is one of my canaries in the coal mine. I can't seem to speak. One of my subscribers, Sheila6325, pleaded with me not to throw it out. So I haven't. She felt that it would come back. And, Sheila, I think you're right. I don't know, don't suspect that this shows up very well and really be able to zoom in, but I will show future progress with this thing as time goes on. But there are little leaves coming out at each one of the previous leaf axils that got killed off in that frost in here. So the canary has been resurrected. I'll show you future updates on him. Well, this is my garlic out in the garden, planted last October, and this garlic will be ready to harvest in August or so when it starts dying back. I cannot remember the name, but I will put it in the list of seedlings, the seedling list below this video. It's what I call an elephant garlic. I don't know if it was actually marketed as that, but it only has four or five very large cloves. I like that kind of garlic better than the smaller cloves for some reason. It also says that it's hot, so I guess that must mean it's plenty spicy. Anyway, not a very large patch. I planted 28 cloves, and so far I have 25 up. I don't know what happened to the other three. They're all in one little corner there. They may come up yet. I might have got them in a little deeper or something, but that's my garlic. It's quite hard to pick it out, but my asparagus has started to come up. It's one little spear right there. There's another little one behind it. And several other of the clumps in this bed. I guess I look over in the corner, I even see larger ones. I should have shown larger ones, shouldn't I? I sort of neglected this bed last year. This is its third year. I should get some harvest off of it. And there are a number of spears coming up in some of the little areas there, so I may indeed get a little bit out of it. But I've got to pay more attention to it this year and give it some more compost and whatever to see if I can't get them larger for the next season. Well, let's have a little look at the cabin, and then we'll close this video down with just a few shots around at some of the spring flowers.
Sorry about the rose bush that's in the way, but I'm proud of that rose bush. I grew it from seeds. I've stained and painted here. I guess the white is a latex paint, and the stain is a solid color stain. Color is called Stonehenge, so I don't know if I should expect large groups of druids to show up any minute or what. Anyway, I'm impressed and pleased with the results, even though I did do it myself. The two trellises that you can see, one between the windows and one opposite the door, those will hopefully have grapevines growing up them. And I would like to think they have sweet peas growing up them, but I have had sweet peas planted in a flat in the hoopos for several weeks now and not a single germination. I never had that kind of luck with anything before, but then I haven't grown them before. Maybe they have a very long germinating period. And the window boxes under the windows there will have some of the calendula in and the geraniums that you'll see in just a minute here. Or I guess you've already seen, actually, haven't you? Anyway, geraniums and calendula. I'll give you a little look at the other side here. Well, that's the north side that doesn't have any windows, and the bit of the front. And now I'll give you a little nighttime view, and we'll close this thing off. It's getting quite dark. You can hardly see the cabin, but you can see the outline of my Christmas lights. I'm all ready for Christmas. I put these on for Christmas last year, and they worked for 2 or 3 days, and then they didn't work for 2 or 3 months. Sometime in late February or March, they started working again. So I took them off to paint the cabin. When I finished, I put them back up again. They work on a solar panel, a small solar panel that charges a battery. I guess they're supposed to run for about 6 hours, but anyway, I'm going to have them going all summer, I guess. Well, thank you very much for watching, and what follows now is just a few little clips of some of the things that have bloomed in the garden since the last update.